Greetings. New YouTube policy changes allow them to post ads for their profit on every video they host. My account is not monetized and never has been. Feel free to skip any ads shown or use the Brave browser. Greetings. If you are Muslim, I encourage you and challenge you to watch this whole video and understand the evidence it offers and the logic it presents. Let's continue with part 3, examining apostasy and how to handle it in the New Testament. But first, let's do a quick review of what we have learned. In part 1, we read the primary ayat in Muhammad's Quran, Quran 489. They wish that you reject faith, as they have rejected, and thus that you all become equal. So take not protectors or friends from them, until they emigrate in the way of Allah, to Muhammad. But if they turn back from Islam, take hold of them and kill them wherever you find them, and take neither protectors or friends nor helpers from them. We learned Muhammad's command is based on assumption and fear, and is a general license for any Muslim to kill any apostate, anytime, anywhere. Then in part 2 we read the verse that Ahmed Deedat offered as his evidence, Deuteronomy 13, 8-9. You must not yield to him or listen to him, show him no pity and do not spare him or shield him. Instead, you must surely kill him. Your hand must be the first against him to put him to death, and then the hands of all the people. We learned the apostate must entice rebellion to worship other gods, and then the person enticed must be the first person to throw a stone, even if the seducer is a close family member or friend. You see, it was not becoming an apostate that merits death. Rather, it is seducing another to worship false gods by another name, like Zeus or Allah, instead of Jehovah. In part 3, let's examine apostasy in the context of the New Testament. The first problem would honestly be to define what a Christian is, in the words of the author of our faith. John 3:3. Jesus replied, "Truly, truly, I tell you, no one can see, enter the kingdom of God, unless he is born again." "How can a man be born when he is old?" Nicodemus asked. "Can he enter his mother's womb a second time to be born?" Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh is born of flesh, but spirit is born of the Spirit." Being born again is your spirit actually being birthed by God's Holy Spirit. Let's look a little more closely at this by using the Amplified translation. Jesus answered him, "I assure you and most solemnly say to you, unless a person is born again, reborn from above, spiritually transformed, renewed, sanctified, he cannot ever see and experience the kingdom of God." In Muhammad's religion, you join by saying Shahada, an oath of allegiance to Allah and Muhammad. Your commitment is not complete if you do not swear to obey Muhammad as well. Nothing more is required at that time. Nothing is sacrificed. No blood is spilled. But Islam demands your oath be binding and will have you killed if you break your oath of words. You should then consider joining the Jewish faith. Members of Judaism generally join at 8 days of age by the act of physical circumcision. Blood is shed, and the cutting away of flesh symbolizes a removal which God promised. Deuteronomy 30, verse 6, "And the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your offspring, so that you will love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, that you may live." Jeremiah 31, 31, "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. So God promised a new covenant, wherein God would write on the hearts of those who believed. God would also circumcise the hearts of his people. And what does that have to do with Christianity? Everything. The revelation of the good news of the Messiah is that Yeshua, Jesus, brought this new covenant. And part of Jesus' revealed new covenant is that your heart must be circumcised to be a member. Romans 2:29. No, a man is a Jew because he is one inwardly, and circumcision is a matter of the heart by the Spirit, not by the written code. Such a man's praise does not come from men, but from God. 2 Corinthians 3:6. And he has qualified us as ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. When he speaks of the letter, he is talking about the law, the Torah, the Old Covenant. This parallel exists between Judaism and Christianity. But there is no analog, no parallel, no similarity in Mohammedism. Remember, we are talking about apostasy because Deedat has attempted to ridicule the Bible, accusing it of commanding apostates be murdered. While Muhammad commanded every apostate to be killed, whenever, wherever, by anyone who found them, the Old Testament does not. It only commands those who have tried to entice someone to rebel against Jehovah God to be killed, and then only by the direct witness. The one enticed must throw the first stone. Does the New Testament that reveals Christianity say anything about those who leave the faith, let alone killing them? Short answer, no. In fact, a big question that divides the world of Christianity is, once saved, always saved. One way to rephrase that is, can one even apostate from the new birth in Christ? This is not a trivial topic and should not be approached with dogmatic, oversimplified rhetorical flourishes. If you search the Bible for the word apostate, your results might depend on the translation you choose. Searching with Bible Hub, I found 15 Old Testament references to the word apostate. In the New Testament, there were none. However, we know the Greek word apostia appears in the New Testament, so you must search for the word apostasy. You will find the word apostasy in 21 verses of the whole Bible. Of these, only 4 are found in the New Testament. 2 Thessalonians 2:3. No one is to deceive you in any way, for it will not come unless the apostasy comes first, and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction. Most translations choose to represent this with the phrase falling away, but the root word is apostia in the Greek. This says nothing about Christians killing those who are part of this apostasy. And on a side note, some well-meaning souls attempt to twist apostasy to mean the rapture, removal, which is absolutely, completely wrong. Acts 21:21. Now they have been informed about you, that you teach all Jews among the Gentiles apostasy from Moses, telling them not to circumcise the children, nor to walk in the customs. This speaks of the Jewish misunderstanding of the gospel of the Messiah and his new covenant. Accusing them of liberty in Christ to mean apostasy from Moses. It does not speak of anyone, even the Jews, of killing those who apostate from Moses. Galatians 3:19. What purpose then does the law, or the Torah, serve? It was added because of transgressions, apostasy, till the seed should come to whom the promise was made, and it was appointed through angels by the hand of a mediator. This is part of a rational argument regarding the need for the law, or Torah. It includes reference to the seed to come to who God made a promise, Genesis 3:15. And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He will crush your head, and you will strike his heel. Again, this says nothing about Christians killing those who are apostates or leave faith in the Messiah. This next, fourth, and final passage that mentions apostasy, I find one of the most troubling and terrifying of the New Testament. Hebrews 6:4. For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened, and have tasted of the heavenly gift, and were made partakers of the Holy Ghost. This is speaking of someone born again, born of the Spirit of God that Jesus spoke about, and have tasted the good word of God and the powers of the world to come. Not idle pew fillers, not Easter-only Christians, not I'm Christian 'cause Mama was Christians. This is someone who is born again, someone who fulfilled the Calvinistic polemic, Thule. In fact, I believe this scripture reference is the basis of the reason for the P in tulip, the persistence of the saints. It is kind of backwards logic. Real saints persist, P. If you don't persist, you weren't an elect Christian, ever. But why is this passage so terrifying? For it is impossible for those who were once enlightened, verse 6, if they shall fall away, apostate, to renew them again unto repentance, seeing they crucify to themselves the Son of God afresh, and put him to an open shame. Just looking at the important points. For it is impossible to renew them again unto repentance. But even after this ultimate tragic condemnation, it says nothing about Christians killing this hopeless, helpless apostate. Instead, it actually speaks of renewing them again, as if the command might be to attempt to win them back to the Lord. But squashes that by saying it is impossible, perhaps implying don't bother trying. But there is certainly no hint of mention of conversation about, but what if they are an existential threat? In fact, one willing to take up that argument must consider that the plan of God is tacitly complete and Satan cannot stop it. If you are Muslim, can you see the differences between the three religions, Mohammedism, Judaism, and Christianity? Mohammed was terrified that Muslims would leave and convince, easily, other Muslims to leave his religion. So he ordered all that left must be killed wherever and whenever they could. Judaism only says that an apostate may be killed if they actually say something to entice a Jew to rebel against Jehovah God. And Christianity says nothing about any negative actions toward apostates. If anything, they are considered pitiable and helpless damned fools. But only Jehovah God actually knows if someone has actually reached that point. So the expectation is for Christians to win them back. And there is no command for Christians to pursue, harass, beat, or worst of all, kill them. In fact, the general command of the Bible for Christians is to love all mankind, even those that hate, despise, and abuse us. Matthew 5:4. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Luke 6:28. Bless them that curse you and pray for them which despitefully use you. Romans 12:14. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. 1 Peter 3:9. Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult, but with blessing, because to this you were called, so that you may inherit a blessing. Luke 23:34. Then said Jesus, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And they parted his raiment and cast lots. Acts 7:60. And he kneeled down and cried out with a loud voice, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. These do not specifically speak of apostates, nor do they exclude them from the prayers, love, charity, and behaviors like forgiveness they command. Deedat's combat kit is shadowboxing another cloud man argument, less real and less logical than an exhale from whatever crack pipe he was smoking. If you are Muslim, do you ever even think how a man so vaunted by your religion could be so wrong on virtually every single point of his most famous written work? You have a chance here to hear the truth and think about it. If you have questions, please post them under these videos. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.